acting more like children than children.
The music of Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass introduces Henry Mancini and the subject of today's motion picture soundtracks. What about the soundtracks of today? How are they basically changing? You've written so many gigantic ones that have become big hits in record sales.
Well, there's a slight trend, not a slight trend, a big trend right now towards what I call a conglomerate score. First happened, I think, in The Graduate, where things that were not written for the picture were put into the picture and done very successfully. And then Easy Rider had that kind of a score. Midnight Cowboy had that kind. And several other pictures out now have that kind of a score. Now, that's all right if it works. I think that the craft of film writing is a little more than selecting the records off the hit chart.
Now, I was wondering, for instance, you mentioned pictures which are basically youth-oriented films. Mm-hmm. And as youth-oriented films become more and more pronounced, do you sense the rock musician will play a bigger role in the scoring of pictures?
Well, if a picture is in that direction, that's the way to go. My point is that I just finished, well, two pictures. One called The Molly Maguires, that had I put anything resembling rock in that, I would have been thrown out of Paramount. And also another one is The Hawaiians. There you have to be very careful because you've got a very pronounced and a very directional story going. You just can't go too far afield as far as contemporary sounds.
Do you feel, though, that Hollywood, in its attempt to get the youth audience, which is supporting so many of today's pictures, may go way beyond the call of duty and attempt to get the rock hit out of everything that's coming out?
No, because I think there are producers and there are directors that resist this because they feel they know what they have in their picture and they are in complete control of the music that goes in. And they could be right or wrong, but they have control, and many have resisted.
Where do you see, as these songs look at life today, and as they are basically a commentary on life, do you think that there's been a saturation point reached in some of the political overtone songs?
I would think that was kind of a short-lived thing a while back, the protest song we had. That was basically during the folk song era we had a few years back. There's too much of that going on now. It's more or less man's being dragged with himself, most of these songs, about his own worries, his own. It's a manifestation of somewhat of the blues, really. He talks about himself and the people around him and things of that sort, rather than, which you might take as political if you want.
Do you feel there's any room left for the sentimental song?
Oh, there's always going to be a sentimental song breakthrough. There's no way to stop it. It's like a big steamroller. You get the big ballad and it'll come through. Many of the Beatles things, you know, although they did some things that had slyly hidden meanings, but George Harrison's new song, Tony Bennett gets that and really sings every note of it. And when he sings it, it makes it a different kind of thing. It's a love song.
Now, besides the Beatles, do you sense that a lot of the rock writers of today are coming up with the standards of tomorrow?
You know, we haven't gone long enough to find out where the nostalgia lies. Whether we, when I say we, our age group, I'm over 40, but our age group went through a very trying catastrophe with the Second World War. Now, that was a catalyst. That was the thing that everybody was thinking alike. Everybody was thinking for one purpose in that time. And that's why I think the big bands all kind of formed a kind of a crystal a crystal clear image in our minds, and that has lasted because the events that caused that particular thing to happen were momentous, you know, they were monumental, let me put it that way. Now things are happening so fast that we had the Korean War, which, now see, there wasn't anything, you don't remember anything musically, you understand, mm-hmm. from that, because maybe it wasn't a big enough war. Maybe you got to get a really big one to get these nostalgia going. And today, you know, Vietnam, nothing musical has come out of Vietnam. In fact, nothing of any kind of consequence has come out of Vietnam. So there has to be that catalyst for the standards to form, maybe hard times. So I'm not sure now whether, let's say, all of the Beatles things, or which of the Beatles things, or which of the Simon and Garfunkel things, or even the Hal Dave and Burt Bacharach, or Jimmy Webb, Rod McKeown. I don't know how much tenacity these things have, only because of the times.
Jean, Jean, the roses are red, all the leaves have gone green, and the clouds are so low, you can touch them, and so come out to the meadow, Jean. Jean, Jean, you're young and alive, come out of your hand, dream, dream, and run if you will to the top of the hill, open your arms, honey Jean. Till the sheep in the valley come home, I'll wait. Till the stars fall around me and find me alone. When the sun comes a-singing, I'll still be waiting for Jean, Jean, the rose. You know the leaves have gone green, and the hills are ablaze with the morn's yellow haze. Come into my arms, Bonnie Jean.
Rod McKeown and Frank Sinatra sing the music of Rod McKeown.
I have been a rover. I have walked alone, hiked 100 highways, never found a home. Still and all I'm happy, the reason is you see, once in a while along the way, love's been good to me. There was a girl.
Is that what most of music is today, basically the personal expression of the writer?
Well, I don't think it is. I think it always was. I don't think it's ever been any different. I think Larry Hart wrote personal expressions. How can you write and not live a lyric like, only my book in bed knows how I look in bed. Nobody hears when I cry. Everybody loves someone. Why can't I? Or she was too good to me. How can I get along now? Or you take Noel Coward writing on the silver screen, he melts my foolish heart in every single scene. I mean, those things have to have some kind of reality within the writer, just as the song Gloomy Sunday. I mean, you can say that we're living in desperate times when people write very desperate kind of songs, but then what about all the union songs that were written by Woody Guthrie and Pete Seeger during the days of the unions here? And what about something like Gloomy Sunday written in the 40s when they were having all the big band songs, and Billie Holiday came out of the 40s too.
Well, why are so many of the young performers of today criticizing the music of that era as being totally unrelated to life?
I don't know that the young performers who mean anything do. Bobby Dylan is very influenced by that music, by the tone structure, by the lyric content. So are the Beatles. You want to start talking about people like, say, a Jimi Hendrix or a Led Zeppelin or someone like that has had an opinion to express on popular music. But I wonder how valid that opinion would be if they did have, because their appeal is limited. Just as, let's say, you know, they sell 50,000 copies or 100,000 copies of an album or whatever, and that's it. Just as I would say that certain classical artists are limited to their particular sphere. That's not the case, I think, with the Beatles, you know, are performed by the Boston Pops.
How have you basically changed as a writer now? You can go back to when the folk craze was in step, the Kingston Trio and Peter, Paul, and Mary, and you were affiliated with many of the Kingston Trio songs.
Yes, indeed. Well, I think I've changed because I've gone into more classical things. I find that classical music is a little purer, and it has a better framework. It has a better framework for all kinds of music because there are certain rules that are very good to live by when you write classical music. As far as the folk music went, I began to find that, well, I like folk music tremendously, and certainly one of my favorite singers happens to be a folk singer. I find folk music very limiting for me. When I was performing it, I never could find what I wanted to find in it. And so there weren't enough ways of expressing myself. There weren't enough things I could do with it. There weren't enough dramatic statements to make. The music, especially, you know, the tunes were, you'd find many songs with the same tune to them. And so I began writing my own songs for myself to sing.
One artist that certainly discovered the Rod McEwen talent in terms of your writing for him specifically, of course, is Frank Sinatra, with one of the big albums recently, a beautiful album. How did this come about?
Frank Sinatra has been a friend of my publisher, Bennett Cyr, for many, many years. Frank was visiting Bennett once in New York. Frank said, "Why don't you write an album for me?" It was difficult to look at Frank Sinatra's face because one of the nicest compliments I guess I've had on that particular album or on anything I've ever written is that Frank Sinatra said something to the effect that, "You really know what I'm about." And that was a very nice thing to hear. And in a way, the reason I feel he might have been right in that respect, Frank and I are alike in one way. We're very much loners. We very much like to go our own way and sort of do our own kind of work. Frank also has an impulsion to work. I found Frank to be one of the most professional people I ever worked with. When we were recording the song, to hear Frank stand out in front of those 40 or 50 musicians singing my songs, and to hear him relate so closely to them because the songs were as much about me as they were about him, twice I had to leave the control room because I was very overcome with what he was doing.
Earlier, you alluded to the point that when we were talking about your days as a folk writer, that a lot of what was happening then and what's happening now is a sameness. Do you think this is holding true in a lot of today's popular music, that a lot of the rock groups are starting to basically create carbon copies of what's
already
there?
I think there always were carbon copies. I mean, when the Beatles decided to stop making records, the Monkees were invented, and they were a blatant carbon copy of the Beatles, down to the technique of the television series involving the same technique that was used in A Hard Day's Night and Help. Now, that is not to say that later on the Monkees didn't go on and do some very valid things. In fact, a couple of them became very good writers and wrote some very unusual things. But it was all started out, it was a cold-blooded audition to find kids that would, you know, be palatable as the Beatles were. The same thing is true of Bob Dylan. When Bob Dylan had his motorcycle accident or whatever it was that kept him out of the public eye for some time, suddenly Donovan was invented. But I mean invented. First, Donovan records were absolute carbon copies, and even the sound of his voice was done like Dylan's, and even to having harmonica and the little cap and the works. Now, later, Donovan, of course, branched out and became not only a superb writer, which he is, but also did meaningful things that were so far different from what Dylan was doing that he was a valid artist on his own. So there you have two good cases of carbon copy things. I suppose what pleases me most about my success is that I never tried to copy anyone, and I never did anything to fill a demand. There was no demand for Rod McEwen. I had to create one.
But when you look at the lyrics of a lot of the rock songs, are the kids looking at these lyrics, or is it really the beat that's getting...
Well, let me tell you something. The difference between Jim Morrison in one of his songs saying, "I hate my mother, I hate my father, I hate this, I hate that," and Johnny Mercer saying the same thing, is that Johnny Mercer says it well. I think that should be the only criteria for doing anything,
mm-hmm.
is how well you can do it and how honestly you can put it across. It's all well and good for rock groups to sing and talk about social comment and social protest and all this kind of nonsense and everything. But meanwhile, they become millionaires. I, for one, am gigs, but rather tired of 13-year-olds and 16-year-olds singing about the hard times. I mean, what hard times? Please. Do they live in a ghetto? They are hard times there, believe me. When a rat takes a bite out of your child, that's hard times.
Rod McKeown is a poet. He's a composer. He's a performer. He's written for himself, for many, many people in the world of entertainment. And his song, Gene, by the time that song goes into history, probably will have as many as 500 recordings. Thanks a billion, Rod.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Burt Bacharach with his orchestra and chorus is featured on What the World Needs Now is Love. Campbell sings one of Jimmy Webb's most popular songs, By the Time I Get to Phoenix.
By the time I get to Phoenix, she'll be rising. She'll find the note I left hanging on her door. She'll laugh when she reads the part that says I'm leaving, 'cause I've left that girl so many times before. By the time I make Albuquerque, she'll be working. She'll probably stop at lunch and give me a call. But she'll just hear that phone keep on ringing off the wall. That's all. By the time I make Oklahoma, she'll be sleeping. She'll turn softly, call my name out low, and she'll cry just to think I'd really leave her.
Sergio Mendez and Brazil 66 interpret the music of Simon and Garfunkel.
Sage, rosemary, and thyme. Remember me to the one who lives there. He once was a true love of mine. Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary.
Popular music has truly become an art form. From the Beatles to Rod McEwen, from Burt Bacharach to Simon and Garfunkel, the music is saying something. Today's music is basically honest. If it were not, it would not have assumed the art form that it has now become. This is Bill Moran.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. Oh, Cilea, I'm in heaven when I see the flame. When I'm laid to my rest.
better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage.